good day and a warm welcome, this time actually quite literally. My name is Rudy van Beurden and this time we will be hosting the fourth series of the Boost program, which is an exclusive program for mobility startups. They are joining us right now live in a team call and you might be watching this through a YouTube live stream. As I said before, the fourth one, we were in conversation with other entrepreneurs as well from Lightyear, Ember Mobility and EV Box before. And today, Carlo van der Weijer, fellow of the TUE, an expert on mobility, will be in conversation with Yuri Steinboeg and he is the COO, the Chief Operating Officer of Avular. And they are building more stable and dynamic robots and drones. And he's really into that, working for about 60 hours a week, but you have to as a startup entrepreneur for sure. And if you want to, you can also send in questions through the live chat or either in the team call, depending on which one you are. And the upcoming hour, we are going to take it away all on the aspects on new parts of mobility. And this time with Carlo again, and also with Yuri. Carlo, a warm welcome,
yes,
also for you,
very
without long
very
sleeves.
Very warm, as you said. It's hot in Eindhoven.
Definitely.
So here in the center of Technical University Eindhoven, so three guys in a shirt are going to talk about what startups can change in the world of mobility. So we like to thank again our sponsor EIT Mobility for this, because it's a nice platform on how this future of mobility will look like, and actually the future is shaped rather by these startups than by just thinking on common practice and trying to exploit that in cities. So these startups are very important for our future mobility, and certainly the one that we have today here, Yuri Steinboeg. Your surname actually brings a lot of expectation, of course. You got some very good DNA, not only by your father, I know your mother as well.
Indeed.
That's maybe even better. So a lot of expectation if you're born in such a family. So good to have you here.
Thanks.
We go back also quite a long time already, because you were a part of the student team Storm back then, those guys and girls that had this crazy idea to build a prototype electric motorcycle and drive it around the world, which they succeeded in 80 days. We met around day 70, I think, in New York when you were there. That was already quite an adventure, but that was a successful thing. Now you're not the second, but the third or fourth endeavor. On Avular. Maybe it's good that we just start a few words on what Avular exactly does, because we heard drones and robots and all the sexy stuff.
Yeah.
So what's this fun stuff you're doing?
Yeah, sure, of course. So first off, glad to be here and glad to be a part of the show, even though it's a high temperature.
Still, yes, it is.
Good to be here. So we as Avular, we really believe in robots. And what we also believe is that you should do what you do best. And what we do best is understand what you need to make a robot. So what we are really working on every day is to make the best tools and the best equipment to be able to create new robotic applications. Now that sounds maybe a bit vague, but to make it more concrete, we have actually three main pillars at this point. The first one is what we call the essentials. It's a modular robot brain. So the idea is you have a machine, and you can attach all the sensors, all the actuators.
So it's hardware.
It's a physical thing. Robot brain. Yeah.
Okay.
It's also modular, so you can really easily extend it with more modules.
Extend your brains. Yeah.
Exactly. Mm. Yeah. So the basis is you can drive your actuators and read out all the sensors. But for example, you have a Wi-Fi standard in the brain. But if you're gonna, I don't know, inspect windmills at sea, then you don't. Well, you can't use Wi-Fi, obviously. So you can also just add a 5G module.
Okay.
Or you can add an AI chip.
Or whatever we make in the future.
Exactly,
9G or something, will be able
They're already working on 6G in Italy. We're also in a project there, so it's it goes further every day.
You already defined the 6G protocols?
What they do. But
that's cool.
Yeah.
It's flexible, modular, and future-proof.
Exactly, and it's really the brains of your robot, so it's really what you need to make from a machine into a robot.
Yeah.
So a cleaning machine into a robot, that's really what this can do. And also there's the positioning systems with that, because every robot, of course, needs to position themselves in the world. So we also have various systems for that. So that is what we call the essentials, so really the basics of what you need to make a robot. Then the second thing we have is our robot platforms. So we have a drone and a driving platform, which actually have these essentials integrated into them. And they can be used to easily start on a new use case if you don't want to make the machine yourself. So let's say you're a company, one of our clients, they have new AI algorithms with which they can process pictures of plants and detect which of them are ill, which have the disease.
Okay.
Now, they can't make drones, and they also don't want to make drones, so what they want to do is to add their sensor technology on our drone, and then our drone, we make sure that the drone flies completely autonomously through the greenhouse, and then they take it up from there, take all the images with position data, and process it to their end.
Okay.
And that's the same also for the driving robot.
And it's also hitchhikes on your essentials. The blocks, essential blocks, are also morphed into a drone, and they do the intelligence.
Okay. Exactly.
Okay, that's the second.
Yeah. And then the third part is our services, in which we actually do integrate these products for our clients. So we have a partnership with iTeam, for example. They make cleaning machines. They don't want to do any robotics engineering themselves. So we, for them, take our own brain, put it in the machine, and then completely integrate it into a final solution.
So this is a, with all respect, relatively low-tech cleaning machine as we used to push them around.
Yeah, when you sit on it.
Yeah. You sit on it and they say, we want to not get rid of, but we want to give this guy or woman a better job. So that's the thing.
Yeah.
And then the robot will do. You robotize anything.
Yeah. And they specifically want to go for the cobotic, so the robot should work with the person.
And that's essential. I don't say we want to get rid of the people.
Exactly.
We're going to give them a better job.
We want to use them where they are best at.
And it's going to get cleaner then.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, that's essential. Yeah. So in this series, we had four different nows, and we focused more or less a little bit on specific things. But I also want to repeat some of them. We had our partnerships. The second one was on finance. How do you finance? You start with friends. I remember the three F: the friends, the fools, and the family that you first rip off, and then you go to the next phase, etc. You're already a bit further. You are already also past that second phase. What was your experience with the financing? How was that about? Did you start with your family and friends?
Well, actually, so Avalar is 7 years old.
Seven years old.
And I joined 3 years ago. We had kind of a restart with a new investor and a new management team, and I'm one of the three management team people. I know that in the very beginning, I think it was mainly a bit from the university, for example, to give it a place to be with, so you could call that friends slash family to some extent.
That's what we do. That's what we do here.
Or fools, I don't know, but
whatever. We tend to think fools, but we are now also in the building where we try nurture them and facilitate them. Yeah.
But for us, it was quite soon. We went into really an external investor. Back then we did it through Startup Bootcamp, which is now HiTech Excel, which is a startup accelerator program that also connects you to investors. And that was really the first kickoff, I would say. What we did learn from that is that it's, so 3 years ago we got a new investor, which is Lumipol from Heze, actually. And what we did learn from that is that it's very good at an early stage to have a really engaged investor, right? Someone that's really close to you, that you know. Preferably even someone you could almost call friends, or at least a good business contact that you really know is a good contact. Because with the investor in China, it was mainly just, here you go, here there's a bag of money, good luck. Yeah, and of course, that's good to have money, right? But we see now that with Lumipol, they really are one day a week at our place, helping us, saying, we have learned these lessons, we have a successful company, maybe you should do this, maybe you should do that. And that maybe even is more value than just the money itself.
Okay.
So if you're going to look for an investor, I would say really try to find an engaged investor that really wants to help you also build your company.
But however engaged they are and friendly, they sooner or later want to, it's an investment, it's not a gift. So there's a business model behind it, you have to show it.
Yeah.
Are you on track? Can you share anything on your business model? When is the break-even point? When is the growth?
For our investor or for ourselves?
It should be the same story, but...
We had this investment 3 years ago, and actually it's going very well, because last year we already made a profit.
You made a profit last year, okay.
Yeah. So actually we made a profit the first year, and then the second year we invested a lot, and then the third year we made a profit again. So in that sense, it's going quite well. We didn't fully get the investment back yet, of course, but that's something we do expect in the next 2 years.
Okay.
We have a particularly nice investor that doesn't say, I want maximum valuation in 5 years from the start, but he really wants a long-term commitment to just build, let's say, the best company we can build.
Yep.
So we're also not focused on getting as much money out in 5 years, but we're really focused on long-term business.
Yeah.
So we are also keep investing any profit we make to just grow our company stronger.
Yeah, it's that, and yeah, that's an investment of yourself probably. You're gonna raising the salaries is also an option what you could do, but that's you're gonna invest everything in.
Yeah, in hiring new people.
How many people? Yeah, because how many people you have now?
Right now we have 28 employees.
And vacancies or
growing. Yeah, we still have 8 or 10 vacancies open, I think. So yeah. So actually we double every year. So 3 years ago we were 4 people. 3 years we went to 28 plus a couple of students, so 35 in total more or less.
Okay.
And at the end of the year we should be around 45 if we can find the right people. That's of course in this
The website avouloir.com, they will find it.
Yeah,
but it's not about that.
Yeah.
It's an exciting area. Nice building as well. Yeah. I was there a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
So
yeah, actually, I think it's mainly difficult to find the people because once they actually come in, then most love what we're doing and find it really exciting. So that's something we definitely have.
Okay, that's a cool thing. I would like to work there when I was there. So that's nice enough. But I don't know. I'm not good enough for that. So the other theme that we talked about, and you also thought it with Tom Selter. We talked in the first thing from how do you go, because that's an, to my point of view, a very important decision. What you do yourself, what you do with partners.
Yeah.
Where Lightyear says, we have to work with partners, otherwise it's a decision.
Yeah.
It's also, otherwise you would need 6 billion in order to build a car in their case, etc. But that still is an option, but they chose to go for partnerships.
Yeah.
Now, you seem to develop most of your hardware yourself.
Yeah.
Where do you link to partners and how do you make these decisions?
That's a good question. So what we really believe in, and of course it's very market and product dependent, but what we really, really believe in is integrated products, right? So that the hardware and the software that they're really made tailored to each other, right? And if you're going to say party A is going to make the PCBs, party B is going to make the mechanics, and party C is going to make the software, then it will be very difficult to really have a good, fully integrated product. So that is one of the key reasons why we make most of the things ourselves. Of course, there are a lot of components we buy in. Yeah, I mean, we're not going to make our own electrical engines or something, right? I mean,
rotor blades.
Exactly. We're not going to do that for now, maybe in the future. But
commodities.
Exactly. That's what, we buy in. But most of the other things we do ourselves. And that has two main reasons in our market. So one is the integrated products, which I really think is a strong advantage. And the other thing is we are in robotics. It's a completely new field. There's very little on the market that is available.
Yeah.
Because most parties have something that was made for automation in big factories or for cars sometimes. Or, for example, if you look at radar chips, then most are actually useful for cars, which have quite more a narrow band usually and a very far distance.
Very far,
Whereas for robots, if you walk around here, you want to see everything, no and idea. 10 meters is fine. Well, not that we're going to make our own radar chips, but that does mean that we cannot just buy off-the-shelf complete components, but that we should buy chips, put them on the board ourselves, and really try to make everything around it.
Or buy such a thing and edit it, but that's not really an option with radar
chips. That depends. I mean, that depends on
it's
what
case by case.
About.
You're going to
exactly
look at that.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it should really suit your business and business model. Of course, what you should also always be wary of is that you don't lose focus, right? Because you can. Well, for Lightyear, I can imagine that interior design is not what they're best at. Maybe. I don't know.
Suppose.
But suppose,
as an example,
if that is not what you're best at, then you shouldn't do it.
Yeah.
Right? So that's also for us, of course. There are definitely parts where we say, well, that's not what we do best. Then we just let someone else who's best at that do it.
Yeah, that's what, in case of Lightyear, indeed, they want to make it as fuel, as energy efficient as possible.
Yeah,
and the road holding should be good enough.
Exactly.
So that's not the main key differentiator that they have.
Exactly.
So what do you see as key for yourselves that you not give into strange hands?
What I see as key is really what you need as an engineer and what works well as an engineer. So the usability of our products, I would say. That's of course still a bit a vague term, maybe.
Usability for the customer
for
or
the customer.
User?
Yes,
or
no, for the customer.
For the engineer at the customer side, so that
for
they
the
can
user,
work
I would say, for the user. Yeah.
For these persons that work together with the cleaning robot.
No, okay. For the person that make the cleaning robot.
Okay.
For the engineers, that's why I said engineers.
Yeah, okay.
So we know very well what they need and what you need to make a robot.
Yeah.
And that is what we really focus on. The only problem is, of course, that that means that actually a part of how you use it is also the mechanics, is also the electronics, is also the software, and is also the user interface. So that's why we do the whole...
And that's why you, and that's what you keep inside. So that's the integration is actually the key that you do there. And
Integration and component design, both.
Cool stuff.
Yeah.
We focus all the different versions of the editions on different focus areas.
So yeah.
We talked about partnerships, etc. Today we have a bit above average attention for the competition and the marketing and how we do this.
Yeah.
So what do you have competition? Because it sounds to be
everyone's
lots of people trying to robotize stuff, and they come from all directions.
Yeah.
Which bigger companies are looking at you?
So everyone has competition, but I think we make quite a broad integrated product that covers many functionalities, and I don't know of any competitor that also makes this one product that can do it all. Mm-hmm. But of course, you can buy a Wi-Fi module or a 4G module, and you can buy a controller or a PLC. Which can do also, let's say, 50% of what we do, maybe, or 40%. Yeah. So we definitely do have competitors, but it's mainly a partial competition. And really one company that does everything we do, that's, I think, hard to find. Companies you can think of, is with PLCs, is Siemens. That's one company that makes a lot of PLCs. And that is definitely, I would say, a competitor, because many people that develop robots right now use PLCs because there is nothing else.
Of course.
That's one of the competitions. There's also quite some companies, but mostly smaller companies that are into sensor technologies.
Yeah.
So ultra-wideband, for example, there are companies in the world that make an ultra-wideband solution. We do too. So those can also be considered our competitors if they also do it in the robotics domain. Yeah, so that depends a bit, of course, on the final domain.
Now, if you know that, you want to distinguish yourself from your competitors, or you want to market yourself, you can buy radio advertisements, that's not the real thing, because you're a typical business-to-business. Right?
So definitely.
So we can leave the business-to-consumer stuff.
Yeah.
For now, you never know.
Yeah.
But you want to have some kind of brand name. That's the thing that's with a lot of startups.
That's very important.
Who knows my name, etc. What do you choose? Did you have some specific things in order? Because Avalar, you see them left or right. You on LinkedIn, you're quite active. I don't know why. I don't know why, but maybe because I have special attention for it. But you keep on reading about Avalar.
Yeah.
Is there some strategy behind it? How do you make yourself known to the world?
That's a good question. I think what is very important is to understand that even though we are doing business to business, in the end, the person buying things or the person making sure that things get bought is a person. So you should brand yourself as if a person wants to buy things from you. And I think that's what many companies do wrong. Like Siemens, they have a very unattractive website. No one goes to their site and thinks, whoa, this is a cool website. And they think it's business to business, so who cares? Because consumers, they get triggered by nice, fancy stuff, and that's what triggers consumers. But in the end, the person buying on the other end is also a consumer.
He's also a consumer.
And he is the person or she that in the end makes the decision. So that's what we really try to do. We try to really make the person behind it enthusiastic. By, for example, what we really notice is that our LinkedIn posts, if we have posts that are personal, so you see me smiling and being happy, or our CEO has had a great day with, this and this, that's what people like. And the post just about, hey, we have this new drone application that gets seen 5 times less than these personal posts. So really to grab the person.
To sexinize your all your messages.
Yeah, I think that's very important.
Is this very active that you say, the picture, try to smile. And I know you smile by
I
definition,
smile all the time.
So I didn't take notice of this. But you said it's these kind of things that you're trying to make yourself known and create this enthusiasm.
Details. So of course it's not about smiling,
but it's about
posting a picture of people and really making it personal. That is what it's about. And I think that really works well.
Yeah.
And because of course if you have a nice smiling face with a purple background, then it's not personal, right? It doesn't feel real. Whereas if you see us all with a nice chocolate letter at Sinterklaas, That's what makes it real.
And with sincere energy and joy. Yeah. So I already had some questions, but I know that they will also pop up with you. I don't also find that YouTube, is it possible to also post some questions in the chat? But at least I see you already waving, so probably the first questions are already coming in. Rudy.
Yeah. So Yuri, you're actually embracing Share the Vibe, I guess, the slogan of the city of Eindhoven that you actually express. But then there's this question by Rick. When you spoke briefly about the multidisciplinary teams, are they being made on forehand permanently, or are they selected based on what the consumer or the customer, the user, wants? Because he says, I can imagine that this is possible when you have 28 employees, as is the case right now. But I'm curious about the earlier phases with less employees, because then sometimes you have to deal, obviously, with the knowledge and the experts within the team that are available. How did you go?
We were maybe, well, I'm not sure if I should say lucky or that it was a strategic decision, but at the very beginning, so it was, we were four people 3 years ago. So we had Albert, our CEO, who's also a mechanical engineer and knows a lot about design. We had Joop, our CTO, who knows everything about software and electronics. And I'm the one who knows everything about control engineering. So from very early on, we already had all these disciplines in-house.
Yeah.
And that's also why, from the very start, we could really start with making these fully integrated products. But of course, in the end, so I definitely would suggest to start as soon as possible with a broad multidisciplinary team. But of course, you can't have all disciplines when you're four people, right? I mean, we had no UX designer, for example. So that's then, so for our product, UX is more of an added benefit.
Yeah.
And mostly software programmers, although they maybe don't want to, and better programmers, they don't find it the most interesting topic, but they can do it.
Yeah.
So as long as you have the core of your company should be completely filled by people that are experts in that multidisciplinary team, and then the rest can be filled up by, well, things you can do, but maybe are not best at. And
then
as you grow, you should also fill the non-core activities.
Definitely. And in your case, the core is the usability of the products for engineers. That's like the core of the core.
And it's also really the integration between mechanics, electronics, and control.
And that was being done by the four of you in the very beginning already.
Excellent.
Thanks.
And what you said, that you you really added competences with the three of you, which is not fully coincidental, of course.
No, of course. You also find
each other, which is also maybe a tip to try to find some different people.
And don't forget the non-technical skills, because that's, of course, also very important. Because if you have three, let's say, tech-savvies that are very good at the technology part, but not so good at doing the rest of business, then you will also have a hard time.
Like promoting or do the soft skills.
Yeah, like promoting, branding, like talking, like doing social media, things like that. Like strategy, finance.
Did you forget in the beginning, or was this already on top of mind from the start?
Social media is particularly not, we definitely thought about, okay, we do need to have a broad team that can cover what you need at least to grow a business.
Yeah.
And we need to be able to think like a business from very early on. And so it's important to have those people as well. So for us three, Joop, for example, is really the planning person. He's structured. He's quite, let's say, conservative. Of course, startup, no one is conservative, but he's conservative. And Albert and I are more the energy and the happiness. And then Albert's really on the branding side, and I'm more on the people side. So that's also very important, I think, to really have these different
and get it in balance. And talk about persons instead of functions. That's also what you do. But now you're much more people, so you see this balance coming back in. Maybe it all this strong name and take it as a compliment, because I do find you now and then. I think it's a strong name, Avulag. Where did it come from, by the way?
Albert made it up.
It doesn't mean anything.
No.
I expected a fantastic story now.
No. He specifically sought for a name that was attractive, not too short, not too long, and that wasn't in the world kind of anywhere.
Yeah, but do that.
And that's very
check the website, available, etc. It can cost you a lot there later.
I mean, if you have a second company that is 200 men strong in Eindhoven that has the same name, then...
That's clear, but it can be a little bit further and growing, etc. So that's the thing, strong name.
Yeah, you should really look for...
Did they invest in the logo? We're talking about branding and positioning yourself. But.
So we three are quite abroad. So Albert is actually also not only a mechanical designer, but can also design...
Here we go.
These kind of things. So he designed our logo.
He did.
All of our logos, actually.
Okay. Now check the website, because that's the thing. The Are there any, because you want to differentiate from your competition, are there any big expositions that you want to go to, conferences, etc.? Is that because it's business to business, it's a little bit strong, they can passively come to you?
No.
What do you on actively getting involved? Yeah. How do you make business?
We would have liked to go to a lot of expositions last year, but there wasn't
maybe,
much.
Yeah. That's which is quite a big share of your entire life.
But
okay.
Yeah. No. So definitely you need to actively approach people. Yeah. I would say if you're a startup in the very early stages, I would not spend money on these big conferences because it's good to for your name to be a bit broadened, but having direct business from it is usually quite difficult.
Yeah.
I would say, again, and I firmly believe in that, it's the people that make the decisions. And if you introduce me to a new startup, then I'll immediately feel some kind of trust towards them because I trust you.
No.
So my advice to any startup would be start by everyone you know and the people that they know.
Exactly.
And usually that's already quite a big field of people, and that should have at least some clients for you. So also if you think of beachhead market, you should really think of, okay, who can I reach as fast as possible within the least amount of time or steps? And usually there's more close to you than you maybe think.
We had some experience indeed, because I linked you to some people. The thing is, I use this, the people that know other people, because you feel a little bit, how you say this, but can I ask for
awkward,
half an hour of this time, these important people, etc.
Yeah.
But coming in as a startup, you also energize other people.
People love to talk.
I always use this one-liner from, spend half an hour with this person, or 15 minutes, because in the end it's going to be an hour anyhow. It's worth the 30 minutes with the energy that you get back, and then people say, okay, give me a talk. That's a very good entrance one-liner.
Exactly.
So that's just a free tip that you get there. And use these people you used me, but probably many else, and maybe your family members as well there. So that's the way.
My own question is, where did you gain this knowledge? Because obviously you did other things with the student team of the electric motorcycle with Storm. But sometimes people have to step over their own shadow, especially when they're still in their 20s, obviously. Where did you gain this boldness?
That's a good question. I don't really know. I've always tried to do new things. So I also was part of the, back then it was called the Honors Horizon program here. So it's an extracurricular program for the whole university, so not just for your faculty, but the whole university. And there I was also involved because we organized a study trip to Denmark and Sweden.
Mm-hmm.
And then, although I wasn't officially in the committee, they asked, hey, do you want to help us with finding some new sponsors?
Yeah.
And I said, well, sure, I want to do that. And then after that, we also organized a study trip to California, 2.5 weeks, with almost no cost for the people participating in the end. So it was really good in terms of sponsoring. And then, of course, we had the electric motorcycle, Storm Eindhoven.
Going around the world. So maybe you personally, you don't really suffer from limiting beliefs that something isn't possible.
Yeah, everything is possible.
Okay, fair enough. Awesome.
I think the most important thing that I've learned so far is if people don't want to help you, they'll say no.
Yeah.
And then they'll say no, and then it costs me 2 seconds to ask you, will you help me? And if you say no, okay, then fine. And it's not like you're going to think less of me because I ask for help. No one will.
No, that's true. Yeah.
Also, a golden lesson maybe for the people in the call, you know, who are mobility startup the entrepreneurs and might think, well, he doesn't have time for me, et cetera, but you're just saying ask them and still they can say no, and then you know what you're up to.
And use your startup enthusiasm, et cetera, because you can ask a little bit more and bluntness, and people will still like you if they say no, even.
Just don't be too arrogant.
That's the
bold
thing. And don't be mad if they say no,
just understand,
they have busy people, etc.
Yeah,
but
exactly.
don't be afraid to ask.
Be humble, but be bold. That's what I
Okay, you take notes at home, please. So those are the right things to say. If you are in an environment of a lot of startups.
Yeah.
Do you see a lot of things that you also steal from them, ideas, or do you also see a lot of things going wrong in this area?
Of course. There's a lot of things going wrong and a lot of things going right.
Also within your startup program.
Yeah, of course. And we learn every day. And that's, of course, also the great thing about entrepreneuring is that you can learn every day. That's what I feel. So lessons I learned, I think... I think you should be at a very early stage with the people you entrepreneur with, because usually you're not on your own, but you have a team, a management team or shareholders that really want to do the same thing. Really discuss early stage in the process what it is your goal is. Because for us, the goal is the stars. We want to be just the biggest robotics company in the world, let's say. Right? That's what we want to go for. And we all want to go for that. I also know people that say, no, I just want to have a good team, 20 people, some very good customers, and that's, I want to really be specialized and do my small thing. And both is fine. It's not like there's a good right or wrong, but it is wrong if one of the persons thinks, okay, we'll go to 20 people, and as long as we make some money, I'm fine with it. But me as an entrepreneur, I want to be still programming stuff, for example. But the other thinking, okay, I want to grow towards this multinational type of company that is... has a global impact, etc. You know, that's really a key differentiator. So I would say that's a, because sometimes I've seen that even though the ideals are the same, so we believe in robots, or we think green energy is the way to go, or whatever, you should also focus on, okay, where do we really want to go as a company? And I think that's something that's that a bit often people forget.
It's because we talked on this many times as well, that this mean transformative purpose that you want to have, this rather more far away abstract kind of mission. It's very important to attract the right people and customers, etc. But you say it also has to be translated to a measurable goal at a certain point. But maybe stepping back to the first one, what is your you said your goal will be the biggest robotics in the universe. That's a goal, but it's probably more a mean in order to change something or something.
Of course.
What's this big, hairy, audacious goal that you set for yourself? How do you want to change the world for the better?
So what I really see, what we really see, is that robots are, I would say, the next step in technological revolution. And like the internet changed the entire world, robots are also going to change the entire world. Every single business where something physical happens in the world will have robots.
Yeah, but let me be the devil's advocate here. Is that a good thing? Do you want to contribute to that?
Definitely.
And why?
Yeah, because it will bring us... what will it bring us? That's a good... I think it will bring us efficiency and sustainability.
Yeah.
A lot of it.
Yeah.
I think it will bring us more joyful people.
Okay.
And I think it will bring us also better... Well, care is also true, but that's, of course, healthcare, but better care for people in general.
Yeah.
And so, for example... I know now that from the grandparents what is it called?
In the verzorgingshuizen.
Yeah, exactly.
Retirement homes.
That the nurses there have very little time for the people. They would want to have so much more personal time, and they don't. Well, robots can solve that, because robots can do all the, let's say...
Everything but...
Everything but the social part, robots can do. Or people in construction work that at age of 40 have no backs anymore. Robots can solve that.
Yeah, and the smartness and the good ideas, let them do that and add it.
And to some extent, I would say autonomous cars, of course, although we don't want to go into that, autonomous cars are also some kind of robots. That they will solve congestion problems, sustainability. They will solve a lot of...
Take the nasty bits out of driving.
Yeah, exactly.
Like accidents and... Yeah. Parking,
Or in chemical plants, when you clean the tanks, still one person dies each year because he enters a chemical tank in a single company. Like Dow Chemicals and Shell and these kind of companies.
Much too many people.
Why?
For this stupid robot-like jobs.
Because there are no robots.
So I ask you, because this purpose, we talked a lot about purpose here specifically. So I learned that startups, and hopefully you yourselves, also think well about this purpose. And I asked you two times why. Why do you do this? I want to be the biggest robot company. Why do you want to be the biggest robot company? Because we want to improve lives. Yeah. Why do you want to improve lives? You can ask yourself the five times why on why you do stuff. That always comes to actually the purpose. But here we go. Are you also actively using this kind of purpose and mission, etc., in order to confirm people of to say that they must join you and must buy your products? Is this a part of your marketing as such, or
not yet so much? And that's because, of course, definitely when it comes to robots, there are also a lot of hesitant people that think, oh, robots will steal our jobs, robots will take over the world. Well, there's a lot of course, negative thoughts about it. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the reasons why we don't really do this big out there yet, because it will give a lot of discussion you don't want. Of course, we do it when you have, for example, interviews with people. Then, of course, we do go over our mission and vision and why we want to do this.
Yeah.
So to get people in the end, yes. In the general public sense, I think we would first want to educate people on why robots are a good thing.
Yeah, exactly.
And then we should say, okay, so we're gonna robotize everything. Because if you say that now, then people will take their hook off and go away.
Okay.
Because people don't want change in an instant. And if you now tell them in 50 years from now, everything will be robotized, they will say, no, we don't want that. Most people, the common folk will say that.
We're going to robotize all the stupid jobs and dangerous jobs, etc. That's what we focus on. It's a positive thing.
No, it's a positive sim for you.
Because I know I'm in the robotic. Okay. Don't overestimate it. What people think about it.
If you want to change the world, you should do it step by step. Because if you want to change the world to tomorrow, that's not going to happen.
But you are convinced that what you are doing is contributing to this better future, because otherwise you probably also won't have a lot of motivation.
So I'm convinced of this end goal,
but
in order to convince the rest of the world, it doesn't help you to just shout it out,
because
that's not going to work. That's going to work with someone that everyone agrees to, right? Green energy is a good thing. There are still, of course, also people that...
Until they put a windmill in your garden, etc.
Most of the people in the world would say, we agree to that.
Yeah.
Whereas robots can be a bit more controversial, so that's why we try to educate the world step by step. By showing them, hey, this is why...
So you're very aware of this thing.
And
it is part of your branding and your positioning, etc.
Yes.
What you're doing and what also the negative sides of that can be.
So. And also when you talk to clients. Because some clients say, but we get paid for our people by the hour. So if you have a robot, then we spend less hours, get less money. That's it. Because for many companies in the world, that's their business model.
These are the people that you should ask the five times why.
Yeah.
Why you want less money? Yeah, so they make profit. Why do you want to make profit? Yeah, because then we're a sound company. And then you end up that they also try to make the world a little bit cleaner, better, healthier, etc. It's a bit abstract, but it's important to do it every now and then. But you get a good thought, including the pitfalls that people might also be a bit defensive.
Yeah,
we come from that. Okay. So, any question in?
I ask whether there are people willing to ask questions.
Okay.
So more than welcome.
Please.
But I have a question actually myself. So, Carly also already mentioned at the very beginning you've got strong DNA, not only your father but as well your mother. Actually, and that's also maybe quite a personal question, but do you sometimes experience being it a burden or standing in the shadow of your dad who is a professor?
This is very personal.
At the University of Technology.
No, not at all.
It's opening doors or neither as well, both.
It's opening doors, yeah, sure. I mean, he's part of my network. He knows a lot of people.
Yeah.
So, I mean... What
you might as well use
who
it.
Who better to help you than your father, right?
I mean,
and mother also. I mean, that's definitely true.
Excellent.
Jordi Cruyff, to give just a parallel, you know, Jordi Cruyff also complained that his father was extra strict to him. So also on trainings, etc. in Barcelona, he had to do extra.
Yeah.
And you just shared with me that when you had your thesis. Tell that.
when I had my thesis graduation project presentation, then of course, well, my father's also a professor at the university, but he was there as my father, right? Of course, he didn't want to grade me or something, that would be weird. So he was there as my father, but he asked a very difficult question.
As an audience.
Yeah.
the most nasty question came from his father.
Exactly. So my mother was really angry with him, but I had a good answer, so he said, I had every confidence that you would answer it.
So you even strengthened even your presentation by giving answer to it. So
okay.
I think it's only a good thing. Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Also a good way to look at it.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. And if it's not, then you should just not use it.
Change your name.
Here we go.
Use your other name.
Don't spend more than 2 seconds on this on disappointment status and continue.
That's it.
Fine.
Yeah, they're not. Okay, so then now going backwards, the why is somewhere that the bigger automation is done. That's also for your positioning good. Then you want to be the biggest robotics. It's a serious claim, the biggest robotics company, because then is what do you have to do to do that, and what does it mean to be the biggest robotic company?
Yeah, so that's not so concrete. And what does it mean?
But make it concrete. What's where you want to be in 10 years?
Where do we want to be in 10 years? In 10 years. Well, if really going for 10 years, then I think I would want that industries worldwide know if I want to do something with robots, then at least, of course, they shouldn't all know us because that's going to be impossible in 10 years from now. But then in 10 years from now, they should, if they Google a bit, they should quite soon end up with Avalar. And they should see many nice robots that they can have an idea with.
But you can measure, you can measure such a thing, huh?
You're recognizable.
So
I think also in 10 years, actually, I think we also want to start to moving towards maybe the business to consumer market as well. Because I think in the end, everything we do in society is for the consumer. Everything. Mm-hmm.
So and they can even influence the B2B business.
Yeah,
I want to have Avalar inside.
Yeah, exactly. So in the end, everything we do is to either give first life needs to people or to make people happier. Yeah. That's kind of everything we do. So if we then do that the most concretely, then you should also go towards, or maybe not really selling to consumers, but at least making robots that interact with consumers.
So you're touching on B2C.
Exactly. Yeah, and I mean, of course, a real robot may be too expensive for B2C anyway, because of course it's quite a big thing usually. Well, vacuum robots or not, but no, I also don't make something that already exists. That's also of course
mowing
not
robots. We now trying to enter our lives, etc.
But maybe as a first step, you could think of robotic restaurant or. Cashiers that are robots that also interact with people, or in hotels that drive you around, or we actually have a project incoming maybe in hospitals as well. So these kind of closer to the consumer type things.
Yeah.
Also, because I believe that it's very important that people stop being scared of robots and that they really become part of our society, and that you will only get that if they are actually involved with them and see how it works.
Okay. So.
That will be what I want to do in 10 years.
In 10 years. But the nice thing is the business-to-consumer angle. We have some business-to-consumer startups as well that probably have marketing-wise and positioning yourself a little bit different questions, but they were. But now it's more business-to-business. And maybe let's just, because all the marketing stuff and all the planning and everything is just to be successful as a company. You said you're already breaking even, etc. You're investing in your own company, so it's the snowball starts rolling. How do you measure at this moment your success? How do you go for what? Where do you see? Do you want to scale up? What's your business strategy actually?
That's of course a very broad question.
Resell, yeah. What do you? Is it reusing of similar components, etc.? Where is going? Where's the leverage in order to really grow?
In the end, what our goal is to sell hardware and software.
Yeah.
Right. And so we make these products like that robot brain, and that's what we want to sell by the thousands. Let's say that's the goal, and that's also where the ramp up is in.
And it's just a pricing for a block that you buy. There's no license or something.
Yeah, and there's software associated with it.
Here you go.
With a software license, if you want to. So there's, let's say, a basic version without a license, and there's a pro version with a license.
With a license, okay.
Of course, we hope that most people will take the pro version.
That's already today the case.
Yes. Yeah, but of course, today it's in the, let's say, tens or hundreds of these things, and we should go to thousands and above at some point. So that's
that's the leverage, yeah?
Yeah. And in our business strategy, one way to do that is by having a web shop so we can sell internationally really quickly, by having also products that are not too expensive. So you should think of for a robotic brain of the basic components like a couple of hundred euros. So that's something companies can also try out without having immediately 60,000 euros for a robot, right? So they can just try out our hardware. The second thing we try to do, so that's really to improve the web shop and to make sure people get there, and we're going for a search engine optimization and things like this, and to really get that going. And the second part, what we do is we find customers that want us to work with them on a robot, make sure we integrate our own components in there for business cases that go into numbers. So for example, the cleaning robot, you're not going to make 100 cleaning robots. You're also not successful if you make 500 cleaning robots. They want to make thousands and thousands of cleaning robots. And if we are there, then our brain is also in there. And then we will also sell, in the end, thousands of brains, of course. So that's the second important
pattern.
So but we also try to so we, in that sense, we do also sell ours, but that's not the goal. The goal is to do a project in which we integrate our own hardware so that in the end, this will lead to hardware sales.
Okay. So now this machine developer in Auckland, New Zealand, finds you and says, that's the block I'm going to need because this fantastic web shop.
Yeah.
He buys 25 with an option of another 150.
Yeah, we ship them.
And ship them and they break down, they want to have service. This is startup from, I'm selling around the world. Do I need agents? Can I do everything remote?
Yeah.
I want to fly around?
To be very honest with you, we're just starting that. I don't know exactly, but what I expect is, again, it's not a very expensive component. Right? So what will happen is it shouldn't break down, of course. We've done a lot of tests that it shouldn't. If it does, they send it back. If they're still in the warranty period, then they get a new one. If not, then not.
And they sent you a bill for not being able to use this very important device for 4 days and all this kind of stuff. I'm being the devil's advocate again.
But I mean, if you in the end, we are a component.
Yeah.
Right? And there's many components. And the Wi-Fi router that usually people use now, it also breaks down every month. That's maybe every year.
Yeah, but I bought it at KPN and I'm going to have nowhere to head to their customer service.
Yeah, so we also, of course, have customer service. Huh?
I mean, okay, that's you're setting
but,
that
but
up.
Not very, but also like, well, maybe NVIDIA is a better example. If you go to NVIDIA, you post something, 2 weeks later you get something back and then hopefully they can help you. But they will not spend hours and hours on doing service. That's not how it works if you buy components. That's also a bit more the type of company that we are.
That is the service level that you want to try to.
Of course, I don't want to wait for 2 weeks. We will have people continuously looking this up.
Yeah.
We will also have a forum in which people can help each other. Because in the essence, it's a development tool.
Isn't it serious? You're setting that up, this kind of stuff?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah.
But that's already an answer to this question, mobilize people in order to help each other.
It's a development tool. And you need really to like Raspberry Pi. But then industrial, that's how you
can. I have some flying around in my children's room as well.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. But you don't call up Raspberry Pi if it breaks.
No.
Nobody does that.
No.
So in that sense, of course, for bigger clients, it also doesn't matter. Because if you buy 150, then you're quite a big client. So then, of course, we'll give more service hours with that deal anyway. But if you really buy one for 400 euros, then you can't expect us to spend 3 hours on you because then all of the profit we make is gone.
I'm just saying they're going to try to
spend
3 hours on that one. And you have to be prepared.
Yeah.
So probably some questions come in on
that. Yeah, definitely. I actually want to add onto this devil's dilemma because you personally the T-shaped engineer, which is also like a thing which was being taught of here at University of Technology. You have to be linked towards different companies, but you also have to be an expert like in the form of a T, but now Samuel, who's in the private call, he's actually asking, so Yuri, how do you balance strength, and I'm actually reading it as like attention, how do you balance attention within a certain industry, vertically, versus being broad and like serving more industries? So then it's becoming more and more complex.
That's a good question. So what we do is actually we focus, our industry is robotics. But another person would say you can apply robotics to any industry in the world, right? Agriculture, inspection, healthcare. Well, you could really, you can make it as broad as you want. But what we do best is actually not to do anything with agriculture because we know nothing of plants. I know nothing of how to farm something. Yeah? That's not our area of expertise.
Mm-hmm.
So what we focus on is robotics. And if you really do that and if you make sure that other people, so partners, so that's where, of course, also the what do you let someone else do? Other people make sure that this robot is an agricultural robot.
Yeah.
So they know everything about the plants. And then in the end, you will see, if I have a cleaning robot that drives around here, it's the same as having a robot with a UV light that disinfects. It's the same as having a robot with a a camera on there that inspects things.
Because it's a modular brain.
Yeah.
So you're creating the brain and they can...
Yeah, you just put something else on it and you have a different application. And you don't just put something else on it because the putting it on is can be a very tedious process.
Mm.
But that's usually what our partners and our clients do.
Yeah.
Because hey, you don't just make a cleaning machine because you have to know, okay, what kind of scrubbing stuff and chemicals and water. It's very difficult to make a cleaning machine.
Yeah.
But the robotics part of it is very similar to all the other robotics parts. So
true.
In that sense, it's
and then still, if you put it like that, you will have to know up until where this line we work on it, and
yes.
then from that line on, our partners will be working on it, and then sometimes the line is being moved a little bit, but in the end you will have the core, the brains, which is modular.
Yeah. So we're maybe a bit of a weird company in the sense that we focus on the robotics market, but actually our applications are anywhere.
Yeah.
And of course, in business development, I would definitely say you should choose a market that you think your product has the most added benefit.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, agriculture is one of our key focus areas because robotics in agriculture is of course a very upcoming field.
Yeah.
So when we look for new clients, we do focus on, for example, agriculture. But if someone comes in with a surveillance robot, although that's not a focus of ours, we can do it because it's kind of the same in a slightly different setting. So.
Up until you're getting too many of these calls and you think, well, we've got now 521 industries and it's time to downscale again or focus.
I don't think we're ever gonna distinguish on, oh, we don't want another industry, because for us it really doesn't matter. Because in the same building you can have one robot that drives around and serve 20 different industries. Because the same robot can bring you a drink, that can do surveillance, that can do cleaning. For us it's all the same. You just put something else on it. And as long as our client takes for his account the putting new stuff on it, we don't really mind.
Modifying it. Yeah.
So the only thing that we really will say no to is to, and that's maybe not application, but environments that are so specific that it's really just for that environment. Like nuclear environments, you know, you really need a robot that's completely every part you need to redesign for that environment. Then we say, okay, we're not going to do that.
Yeah. So Samuel is adding to it, and maybe we can get him in live as well.
Ah,
so
cool.
Your partners will have the know-how, and maybe being certified as well, having certified products based on your hardware.
Now you asked his question already.
Yeah, I don't know if he's hearing us or seeing us, but maybe.
But okay.
If you can swing on your camera, Samuel, then Yuri can actually see you as well. Feel free. So they need to be certified, or.
Ah, here we go.
Hey Samuel.
Yeah, there he is.
I think the sound is off,
so
though.
Which screen I am on for you? Nice to meet you.
Yeah.
Super interesting discussion, but I think I always find that very difficult of who has the know-how to solve the problem, right? So you can you can be the microprocessor, you can be the software, you can how does it work? So when you say you want to be very integrated, usually that also includes the end solution, and now you're saying, yeah, we want to be everything integrated, but... applicable to everything. So how do you balance that? That's kind of the question.
Yeah. So in the end, for us, we really stop at when all the data is gathered. Right. So our clients are the one that actually take the data, and then I'm not talking about position data, but mainly about pictures or other sensory data that you conclude. Okay, this plant is sick, or there's a person here that shouldn't be here surveillance-wise, or it's not clean yet. We gather the data and we make sure that the client knows where this data is taken, and they do the rest. So we really focus on moving around in the world, being safe around the world, so also being safe around people, right? That's also what we do. But once we have something that can move around and that can really do everything that the robotics part is, then from that moment on, the client has to do it. Or if they want us to, of course, we can ask other partners to do it for them. But that's really where we end. But I definitely agree. It can be a very difficult thing to distinguish where is this balance. But on the other hand, I would say the first question there's two questions you should ask yourself in any startup company. What do you do best and what do you love? And as long as you do things that you do best and you love, then it's fine. And as soon as you go into some thing which you don't do best or you don't love, then I would say you should let someone else do it.
Is that both love and being good?
I would say yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you love things and are not so good at, you don't start learning it because it goes fast, but try to focus on, if there's enough that you love and do good at, stick to that.
Yeah. Usually there's a combination to find. Because in the end, we could also make, I don't know, automation stuff for assembly lines. We could do that. But I just find it boring. So I could not give all my energy and really be completely involved in really making this a success because I don't love it. So that's why I say I love robots. As my whole life, when I was 8, I already wanted to make robots. And that's why I can give all this energy and also get a lot of energy back. And of course, you should do something you're best at, because if someone else is much better than you, well.
Why not? Let him do it.
Yeah, why would you do it?
If he loves it and does it well, that's...
Otherwise, you're anyway going to be out of business, because other people do it better. So
yeah, that's right.
Does make sense.
Macroeconomically, it's best that everybody does what they do best.
And of course, there's always some things that you add that make your proposition better that are mainly not completely what you do best and love, but...
Maybe. Approaching the end, you said an interesting thing that because you work by definition very tightly with your customer that does all the a lot of intelligence and get access to the data, etc.
Yeah.
Aren't you afraid that one of these clever customers at a certain moment, because they see exactly how your machine works and what it does because of this data, says from, okay, copy paste and I push you into commodity or...
No.
And do you protect that actively, or do you think that your entry barrier is that high that you're on a safe side?
Yeah, but in the end, the customer doesn't see exactly what it does. Because you can drive a car, but you have no idea how it works. Maybe you do, but...
But
general people don't.
No, but in this business to business, it might be that they can have quite a deep look into you. Do you protect that actively, or...
Yeah, so what we try to do, I didn't fully say that yet, but we do try also to make the programming as easy as possible.
Yeah.
So to try to have, let's say... visual programming, so drawing lines and putting blocks in.
Yeah.
But everything that's behind that, they won't see. And that is because we want to make it as easy as possible for them to do it. But in order to copy how to do this visual programming, that's a very big step that you don't see.
Okay.
Right? And also in terms of, for example, the positioning. And we make maps of the world and we position ourselves in that world. But in the end, what the customer sees is just there is a map and the robot knows where he is. But how the robot built that map,
they won't have any insight.
No.
And that's the IP or really... Do you have covered in IP as well? Do you have licenses?
So we do have IP.
Okay, so you protect it in IP, but also by hiding it and...
Yeah, so software-wise, you just make binaries, ones and zeros. You can't see anything of it, so that's software-wise. And mechanically and electrically, we protect it with patents.
Okay, that's cool. Now, okay, this is a very general thing that also probably concerns much of the other startups.
You need to
be able to get the differentiation, protect that well, because otherwise somebody else will copy it and push you in commodity, and that's of course not
really good. And I also believe if you really do something you're best at, then it will be very hard for someone else to copy it.
So that's the thing, and love what you're doing and trying to combine that and focus on that one. That's maybe good to end with, because I don't know if there's a very urgent burning question from outside, because we have the last minute of the last session now.
True.
I would like to thank you because that you were available of the 60 hours a week that you work and a few hours of that, of probably on top of that, you spent with us. So that's very, very much appreciated.
It's great to be here.
Who knows, it might lead also to a combination with somebody that's watching at this moment, but... keep up the good work.
Thanks.
And thanks for being here. Really enjoyed
it.
Like I enjoyed the four sessions that we had here that also now come to an end. Thanks to the technical guys that you have never seen that were behind the screens here and made everything work quite smoothly. And I give it back to you, Rudy.
Definitely,
thanks for having
Carlo. So it's a wrap after four sessions. Quite some takeaways. I've been penning down all these insights as well, because Yuri, you're just like so wise and so grounded. You come up with so many takeaways, like be modest, be bold, but also align your goals with your co-founders at the very beginning. Like money pouring in from China might come in handy, but maybe it's even better have a funding partner who is down the road and who can actually come over and give you advice as well. So the founder needs to be engaged. And yeah, Carlo, also from you, you said before you need to start with a stupid idea. I don't know if this actually is a stupid idea. I guess it's actually a genius idea, but in that sense, like, it should be big and
but
people
the real differentiating stuff that they do also started with a stupid idea.
Yeah.
That's if it would be a normal idea that you start with, then other people would also think about it.
Yeah.
So don't be too afraid of acting a little bit strange, especially if you have still the love and enthusiasm and you are good at something. That's already a head start. So
And my last advice would be, don't be afraid to fail. Because in the Netherlands, we really like, we have to be successful from day one. Mm-hmm. If you don't, you can fail. That's fine. You can have 3 startups and then learn and then have another one. It's not bad to fail as long as you learn from it and grow.
And there's a lot of criticism in the Netherlands that we are so afraid to fail. But we have also a good backup system, which is on itself.
Yeah,
so you will never end in poverty. So take a bit of risk. But there's a lot of people from other countries as well. And I'm quite sure they will find their way. Don't
True.
Be afraid to fail. We will still like you afterwards.
Exactly.
Definitely. Yeah? So you either win or learn. We can reframe it like that. You either win or learn. Yeah. Carlo, thank you so much for the collaboration, for the 4 sessions. Those can be viewed back, if you like to, on YouTube, on the Open Webcast channel, but maybe also with TUE, and then search for the Boost program. Maybe we will be back later this year. And then a silent wish of me is to have some female founders as well. Who knows? Because now we had 4 guys. But the insights were plentiful. So there's like 4 hours of footage you can watch back. Maybe whenever you are at the edge of a swimming pool. Because that's actually something I'm going to do rather soon. I'm going to check out and seek myself a swimming pool with these temperatures. My name is Rudy van Beurden. And I hope to see you soon anywhere, anytime. And enjoy your summer. Good day.